Hi, my name is Giulia Panozzo, and I'm a neuroscientist or marketer. And today I want to talk to you about behavioral data for search. And the reason why I want to talk about behavioral data is because we've witnessed so many changes in the past 12 months alone. Not only in the search landscape, because we witnessed AI overviews becoming a thing, and then organic product carousels and filters in the SERP, which have impacted both transactional and informational queries, but also we witnessed a change in search behavior. Now users are more attuned to making queries that are more conversational. They're using several channels to do their searches. So they're not only searching on Google, they're using LLMs, they're using socials. So their searches are omnichannel. And it is believed that by 2026, 25% of traditional search engine volume will drop in favor of AI chatbots and other virtual assistants, according to a research by Gartner.com. So SEO now is getting evaluated on journeys that are no longer linear and are driven by the user. And as SEOs, we've always been shy talking about user behavior and user signals because they weren't official ranking signals. But now we have the duty to report on them because according to the latest data coming from either the Department of Justice trial or even the most recent research by Mark William Cooks that I recommend everyone to get familiar with, have pointed to the importance of user signals in determining rankings. And this has led to a knowledge that SEO is no longer about getting a click to the website, but it's about the entire journey, something that is now known as SXO, Search Experience Optimization, which includes SEO, but also UX and CRO. And what these disciplines have in common is the user, which is the end beneficiary of any optimization efforts we make. So SEO might be dead, as we know it. But the future of search is analyzing and predicting user behavior so that we can optimize accordingly. And when we talk about users, we're talking about people who make decisions all the time and are often biased when doing so. And we're not going to talk about cognitive biases today because it's a massive topic that you can familiarize with on your own time. But it all boils down to two main things that we need to master as SEOs and search professionals. Learning how to capture and retaining the attention of the users, and also learning how to foster a connection so that they can keep coming back to us when they need that something that we can offer. This is all obviously provided that we are relevant to their search, which is always the first thing that we want to provide. And this is why we need to rely on other measures that might encompass the entire journey rather than only getting to the clicks and that are more reliant on behavioral data rather than only search engine data. So analyzing user behavior from an SEO perspective is sort of what a doctor, I imagine, would do when analyzing a patient. So they would listen to their complaints and their symptoms. They would try to find the root cause with some analysis, and then they would prescribe a treatment. And the same we need to do with our own data that we have available. So there's normally three steps that I go through when analyzing user behavior for search. The first one is exactly analyzing the symptoms. So this is normally the easiest step because you don't even need to look for anything. Symptoms will be brought to you by your leadership team most likely. These are normally, you know, the high level losses that you might that might be brought to your attention because they have a business impact. So for example, a loss in traffic, lower impressions, lower rankings, lower AOV. But there are outer manifestations of something that's not quite good on the inside. So you need to dig a little deeper. And that's where the second step comes in. And the second step is analyzing what the root cause might be. And we have several diagnostic tools at our disposal, which can give us three different levels of data to analyze. So the first level is the basic diagnostics. This is the kind of data that we don't need a tracking setup for, nor specific buy-in. Then there's the next level data, which is where you normally need some tracking set up. And then the predictive data, which is the harder one to get, the harder kind to get because it relies on specific training or maybe specific equipment. So we're gonna see each one of them to see how we can carry on with our analysis. So the first level is the basic diagnostic. One of the tools that we have available actually is Google Search Console already. For example, we can look into low CTRs because this gives us, paired with high search volume, already a measure of where there might not be a good intent match from the user to what we offer, both from a non-branded and branded perspective. And then the rest of the diagnostic tools in this sort of area are more of the qualitative side, and you might need to collaborate with teams on your end to get that data, but it's really, really valuable. For example, you get data from service, you get data from customer experience logs, or maybe some live user testing if you can run it, because these are all the data that user proactively come to you with, and you can gather all of them to understand common frustration points. The second type of tools that we can use give us the second level of data, which is the next level data. And you might need some tracking set up for that. These are tools like Web Analytics, for example, GA4 or Adobe, or anything else that your company might be using, and heat mapping tools. These tools record user behavior on your site. So it's not something that users are telling you with words, but it's something that users are telling you with their behavior. So there's still some kind of inference that you might have to apply when reading this data, because it's mostly quantitative data. So I always encourage to look at this data in pairing with some of those other qualitative data that you can get out of the tools in the basic diagnostic. So some of these data can, for example, be engagement times, engaged sessions. Internal searches are massive because they can inform on, for example, the information architecture. It might not be clear on your website, or you might even find out that you have no index pages. So people are looking directly on your website for categories or products that are not readily available via your navigation or your browse path. And there is many other things that these tools can inform on, for example, points of abandonment, how far they scroll down the page. And this is also something that heat mapping, for example, can help record. How far do they go down the page? Do they click on something that might be a dead click, a narrow click, or something that doesn't actually work? So all of these metrics can inform on not only on what your users are looking, but also what might not be working within the journey, informing on the frustration points again, but from a quantitative perspective. And finally, we get to the predictive data. This is the data that is the hardest one to get, because it relies on a specific equipment, most likely, and then a certain level of training to read. These are going a bit deeper than the basic diagnostic and the next level data, because they tell us about something that not even the user might be able to tell us. For example, eye tracking. They tell us not only where they don't scroll, but also what they don't actually see, because they might be scrolling on a page but not actually see the CTA because something else catches their attention and we're not aware of that. Also, there's other measures like electrodermal activity, or functional magnetic resonance imaging, or EEG, electroencephalography, that can inform on neural activation in response to marketing stimuli. And this is what helps us predict a preference that the user might not even be aware that they have. Okay, so now you found out all of these diagnostic tools that you have at your disposal, and what do? You prescribe your treatment. And depending on the size of your business and how many teams you have to collaborate with, you might want to prioritize these fixes. So what I recommend you do is to ask yourself, what's the time and effort involved in this fix? How critical is it for the business in terms of actual, you know, like, is it a nice to have, or is it something critical because it blocks the journey to conversion? And what's the actual impact of ROI of me implementing this fix for the business? So this will inform your prioritization matrix, where everything with high impact will get done either now or later. And everything with lower impact will be either not done or done later down the line. And my bonus tip is to document not only your fix for that specific instance, but also what does the fix actually solve at a deeper level? What is the user need or user bias that it solves for? Because these will allow you to find new opportunities in other domains. For example, if I see that people are looking for returns and I optimize for them to make them more available on page and off page, that means that I am optimizing for loss aversion. People do not want to lose. So that can be applied to a number of other domains on site. I can, for example, if I have a tool, I can offer a free trial or a free sign up with no credit card required, which helps us save time and money from a user perspective. And to sum it up, I would say Although we are search professional and we were trained to look after search engines, it is now our duty to look at the entire search experience as a whole and to use behavioral data to inform our strategy moving forward. So don't let your title make you shy away from behavioral data. And if you want to learn more about a search experience optimization or behavioral data for search, please feel free to connect with me on LinkedIn. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you soon.